So first, I would like to thank the organizer for the invitation. And I will present you today a kind of summary of many studies regarding surface deformation in AFAR. And the objective of this talk is to see if we can consider the divergent plate boundary as other amagmatic frontiers and point out the role of magmatism on the short-term evolution of the rift at the first stage of oceanic continent transition. So the dynamics of over time of divergent plate boundary, how should I do? Sorry, I'm not, I'm lost, sorry. I will do like that. Huh? The dynamics over time of divergent plate boundary at slow, very slow, or even intermediate, there is a problem, one intermediate rate is seen as an alternation of magmatic and tectonic phases. And the opening across a segment is dominated by magmatic dilatation with the injection of dikes usually laterally into the rip zone. And during periods of lack of magma, the extension is accommodated by normal faulting, tilting the lava pile and the dikes. So these alternations are observed in a time scale estimated between 10 to 100,000 years. But over the short time period, on a time scale of 100 years, the classical view of the evolution of the rift is quite similar with magmatotectonic alternation over short periods. And following the injection of dikes during a diking episode, as it is observed in Iceland, in AFAR, or even undersea, if no magma is available, the slip of normal fault will occur in response of the regional stress field, building over time the morphology of the rift. However, this short-term alternation of magmatic and tectonic activities does not fit with the idea of diking cycle, which would be the parallel of seismic cycle for other frontier as subduction or transform boundaries. And the co-diking phase corresponds to the occurrence of large transient events, in this case, the intrusion of the opening of a magmatic fissure at depths associated with large displacements on surface. And the dike intrusion would catch up the deficit of opening at the boundary imposed by the plate tectonics. But when the displacements are significant enough, a post-diking deformation will occur, and we will see, as for the other boundaries, post-diking deformation or post-seismic, or here a post-diking deformation, driven either by an active process, which would be a slow dilatation at depths, or by a response of the medium. With the viscoelastic relaxation of the lower crust or the upper mantle. So during this phase, the slip of normal faults are generally observed. And finally, by analogy with the seismic cycle, the interseismic period, there is the inter-diking period, which corresponds to the accumulation of elastic strain at the level of the boundary. And this is on this phase that I want to focus today. First, so the question is it reasonable to make the parallel of seismic cycle or diking cycle for divergent plate boundary? So even if several similarities exist regarding the evolution of the displacement field over time or over space, over a cycle, the main difference will have an important effect on the mechanism of loading and unloading the boundary, and especially because along divergent plate boundary, we are not talking about one interface, but or several interfaces, but it's way more distributed over a wide area. And also the brittle layer is generally seen, and more importantly, there are many processes which can potentially perturbate the stationary system, and such as the presence of magma or hydrothermal fluids. So like for other frontier, focusing on the interdiking period and slow distributed deformation requires to follow the surface deformation with a high spatial and temporal resolution using mainly geodetic and seismic measurements. So in Iceland, here where the boundary is well established, horizontal velocity confirm that there is an accumulation of extensional strain at the level of the ridge, and with horizontal gradients distributed over a large band around the boundary, which can explain a shallow part of the boundary which is locked to a certain depth, as it is the case for their frontier. So in afar, in afar, this is not the same configuration because the spreading ridges are young and not totally established, especially in central afar. And the volcano-tectonic segment associated with the Red Sea or with the Aden Ridge propagating onland are not all of them at the same evolution. So for the Red Sea, the most evolved segments are in the northern part of Afar. And the recent result of Viltres show the gradual increase of the horizontal velocity with 90% of the deformation concentrated in a large band of more than 150 kilometers. And with its velocity field, which is consistent with a large locking depth of 12 kilometers. However, the history of this segment here at the north of Afar, it's not really well known, and it's not easy to have a good understanding of the relation between the deformation and the magma activity. In the other part of Afar, the GPS velocity field and the INSAR data reveal some interesting observation on the deformation of the segments when magma is not always involved, except for this large yellow velocity, which are related to the Mondaro sequence in 2005-2010. In the other part, there is no magmatic activity, and all the data available for the last 20 years confirm that the displacement gradient revealed very few fault activity, neither on volcano tectonic segments or nor in the transform zone. However, smooth gradients are observed across the Tajura Bay, so the western tip of the Aden Ridge propagating westward, and across the Assal Rift. And we note that there is a regular increase of the horizontal velocity, which occurs even west-south in the southeastern Afar, and far from the ridge, and I will come back on that on the next slide. Another interesting result is that we do not observe any extensional deformation across the Mandainaki Rift, which is a young rift, and it has been affected by a rifting diking event in 1929, as suggested by basaltic eruption and also surface deformations of such as the open fissures or offset of vertical normal fault, vertical offset of normal fault. So the Assal Gubbio Rift has been affected in 1978, and thanks to the early instrumentation, geophysical instrumentation, the opening rate has been measured since then. And the evolution of the length of two baseline crossing perpendicular to the rift axis show first the high opening rate during the post-diking period, but more interestingly, we can see the decrease of the opening rate over time, which is still going on many years after the diking event and after the end of the post-diking periods. On the right, looking at the velocity field over two periods, one in brown and one in purple, there is a clear, it is clear that the extensional deformation is more and more distributed over time with respect to the rift axis. And the evolution of the velocity profile, so in purple for the first period and in brown for the last period, this evolution would be consistent with the deepening of the locking depth. And in another word, that the rift marks less and less the divergent boundary with time. So if we look closer at the activity in the Assal rift during the inter-rifting periods, the surface deformation from INSAR or from GPS show very, very low deformation and false slip during the inter-diking period. The small seismic slip that we were able to measure through INSAR correspond to occur on a short time periods when the microseismicity was revealing small pulses of activity at the vicinity of the central volcano. But since then, the seismic activity is almost null and no fault slip has been detected as well. And this observation over a short time duration are consistent with a long-term observation which confirmed the mineral of tectonic extension over 100,000 years, and that most of the fault slip occur during the diking periods. So together with the observation of the young Manda Inaki rift, which is completely inactive, and this rift suggests that in case of non-availability of magma, tectonics does not take over the accommodation of regional extension, and the strain is more and more distributed over a large area and not only at the boundary. So I would like to point out two interesting events which occurred in South Afar. They are revealing an off-axis extension at more than 200 kilometers from the main active segments, which are expected to localize the deformation associated with the northwestward motion of Arabia in Central Afar. But both of the events have been detected using dense geophysical surveys or INSAR data. First, the event in May 2000, located at the northern tip of the Mid-Ethiopian Rift, where the structures are consistent with the divergent motion of Nubia and Somalia. And using INSAR and seismic data, current collaborators evidence a dike injection matching not this divergent motion Nubia Somalia, but the motion northwest, the northwest motion northeast, northeastwards motion of Arabia. So second, a sequence of seismic events located far from the active segments again, southeast of Afar. So too few INSAR data were unfortunately available to precisely investigate the surface deformation, but the earthquake relocation draw a nice alignment alignment in the northwest direction, and this alignment follow, I don't see if you can see, follow a really nice chain of young monogenetic cones in an area where also we can see really nice recent basaltic lava flow. So by analogy with what we observed during the recent diking events, it seems that this data suggests an intrusion one more time far from the location of the ongoing establishment of the divergent plate boundary. So following the dynamics of divergent plate boundary during interdiking period remains necessary to understand how deformation is accommodated and estimate the location of the accumulation of elastic strain in the lithosphere. So this is important to shed light, of course, on the volcanic and tectonic hazard, but also to draw the evolution of the oceanic basin and the formation of the oceanic basin and the respective role of magmatic and tectonic process over a long time. And it can help to consider change plate boundary as other boundary and understand the short-term deformation field in the framework of Dyking cycle. And the observation we made suggests that alternation of magmatic and tectonic are not appropriate to describe the segments over a short-term period. And the monitoring of surface deformation showed that the role of faulting should be minimized during interdiking period within the rift zone. So in the case of Afar, where the boundary is not completely set up, at least in central Afar, when the magma is not always available at shallow levels, the extension is more and more distributed and located. Transient event could occur of be available. Or also, I didn't talk about, but it could occur also along a tectonic structure which are more developed, like the marginal grabens along the margin on Afar or the large normal fault. So this result can give an insight for the understanding of the long-term deformation of oceanic basins. And I think they should be taken into account in the long term for drawing the evolution of the transition ocean continent. Thank you.
Thank you, Cecile. We have a bit of time for one or two quick questions. Suzanne, you have one?
Yeah, thanks a lot, Cecile. I was wondering a bit how to average from short term to the long term. So say when I run my numerical models, I have time steps that are, if I'm optimistic, 1,000 years, but sometimes 10,000 years. So if I want to take into account this interplay between magmatic and tectonic, what should I do?
Well, in this case, when we're working over a long time period, for me, long time period, it's 10 to 100,000 years. The alternation is clearly exists. The magmatic alternation, we can see it in the geology, in the seismic profiles, and emerge ridges, but at the short-term period, and for me, this is just the loading, if we do the analogy with the seismic cycle, just the time of the logging, so that would depend on the far field velocity field, or the far velocity field, or the, so it will be around 100, 200 years. For me, this is the short-term, as we can see in other frontiers.
Thank you, Cecile. One last question, Leticia.
It was just a short question, Cecile. Mm-hmm. It's just looking depth for faults, I understand. And what I see in the chat is for a dike, what is the mechanical, physical meaning? And I was asking, like, maybe it's because your magma is freezing and you are recovering with some kind of time scale, the strength locally, or? So what is this looking depth?
Well, the looking depth is just the you know, to explain your velocity field, and adds, from these depths to the surface, your boundary is locked.
Yeah, but what does it mean? Because for a fault, I get it, but for a dike, it just mean it's still opening at depths.
Yeah.
Okay.
But it's the mechanical explanation, you know.
Mm. Okay. Now I was just wondering, it's just like the depth at which the magma is frozen, so it's hard again, and then you actually have less deformation. And then we could upscale it to answer Susan's question.